Welcome back to another episode of, what is it? Ask Physio Online.
Go Jolly.
Yes. Good start.
So hopefully there's a few people out there watching us. Thanks so much to everybody who sent in your questions. So we'll hopefully get through a few of those tonight. The other thing we just want to say is some of the questions I'm answering are quite private and people, you might not want to comment below the question, but absolutely send us a private message on Facebook and we will look at them as we go along. So if you don't want anybody to see that you're watching or commenting, just send us a private message and we have it up here and we can go through here. So hopefully there's a few people watching. Let us know.
Yeah, so the feedback was pretty good from last week. There's one criticism in that I spoke too much and I need to stay quieter and just let Kira do all the talking again. So I'll stop trying to interrupt her and just let her go on a ramble. Oh no, wait, that was the other way around, wasn't it? Kira was talking too much, that's right.
Doesn't sound any at all.
Joke. Right, I'm going to kick it off.
Yes, so one of the questions we had in, hold on, let me get it up here. Here it is, all right. Hopefully you can hear us okay. This question is a lady asking us about her mother. So my mother is 68 and was told last year after a DEXA scan that she has arthritis in her hip. No advice was given other than to take calcium supplements, which she has already been taking for the past few years. Would physio help, and are there exercises that would strengthen her hip? So it's a sort of a two-part question here. We probably need to clarify a little bit.
So a DEXA scan is more for osteoporosis. It's what they use to, it's a bone density scan basically. So it gives us how dense your bones are. So with osteoporosis, the bones become less dense and quite weakened in structures. So they generally go for a DEXA scan for that. But so it's clarifying as to whether or not it's osteoporosis she actually has in around that hip. Which would be widespread really, as opposed to just at the hip, but she might have a higher
in some areas, hips and back areas. Is a little bit higher.
Or if it's actually osteoarthritis, which it potentially could show up on the actual scan as well. So, there you go.
Is that all you got? Yeah, so DEXA scans are to find out if we have osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is silent. So we don't know really that we have it unless we pick it up on a DEXA scan, or more commonly is when people actually fall and they fracture. They might have a simple fall where they might trip and they fracture, and then we'll find out once they get to hospital, it'll trigger a DEXA scan, which will show they have osteoporosis. Most common people with osteoporosis, Ollie?
Are women that have gone through the change. And again, this
the
is...
The tune.
This is due to the hormones again changing, so it leaves them a little bit more vulnerable and weakens their bones.
Yes. So osteoporosis, as Ollie said, is where the bones become weaker. Osteoarthritis, on the other hand, is when there's age-related changes within the joint. So all of us are likely to be affected by osteoarthritis at some point in our life because it's the normal aging process of bone. But we do manage the two of them slightly differently. So I think from the DEXA scan, let's assume first that it's osteoporosis, and maybe the person that asked this question, if you're listening, you can clarify, is it osteoarthritis or osteoporosis? Because you wouldn't really pick up osteoarthritis on a DEXA scan. That will be done through an x-ray. Mom has osteoporosis, what can they do?
So again, we know that bone remodels to the load applied upon it. So what that simply means is weight-bearing exercise or weight-bearing activities are really good for osteoporosis. Gentle weight-bearing, obviously we don't want people going out pounding the road as hard as they can to get that load going through their bones to get them to strengthen them. Making sure that they are on the correct supplements, and there are quite a few different supplements out there. So some people get injections, some people take tablets, some people take it. Monthly tablets, so I'll just take it daily and things.
It's your doctor.
So loads of different things. So it is worth going to your GP and discussing that further with your GP, making sure you're on the correct medication for you. And then often what they do is they set you on a course of treatment, and then they'll re-scan you, do another DEXA scan to see exactly if the density is changing in your bones, because it actually can. It's not a case of that it's just as is and just gets gradually worse. You can actually improve the density.
Yeah, so what kind of when we have patients with osteoporosis that come into us, generally, as Ollie said, we'll want to get them weight bearing as quickly as possible. So some of my patients lately that I've thought of with osteoporosis, I've tried to get them walking if they can tolerate it pain wise. Simple things like step ups.
Yeah.
Getting them to go up and down on their step can be really helpful to increase bone density. We try to avoid with these patients, well, not avoid, but we wouldn't encourage things like cycling or swimming, because that won't increase your bone density. And that's a big difference between osteoporosis and osteoarthritis. With our patients who have osteoarthritis, often load-bearing exercise is painful, and therefore we would encourage things like cycling and getting in the water. So there is a big difference there on how we'd manage them. But I think the key message is that whether it's arthritis or osteoporosis, there is things you can do to help. It is not a case of, I'm getting older, this is something I have to accept. As Ollie said, we have seen our patients who have taken the supplements, combined it with weight-bearing exercise, and in 12 months, their DEXA results improve. So,
and it's not just lower limb weight-bearing exercise, so yeah. It's weight-bearing through your arms as well, so it's getting your load going through your arms. So it might even be something like wall push-ups or push-ups on the table, or even just four-point kneeling, just actually holding that position, or trying to do maybe some activities in four-point kneeling, crawling around, different things like that, that just gets that force going up through. So it's not just the lower limb, it's a bit of upper limb, spine, and legs.
Yeah.
And the classic term that's banded around that probably should be done away with definitely is brittle bone disease.
Oh, yeah.
So people call it brittle bone disease, and straight away when someone hears that they have brittle bones, they don't want to do exercise, they don't want to do anything, and that just makes the whole thing worse. So I've had someone come into me that was afraid to actually bend, because they were told that if they bent over, their spine would break and fracture, and that wasn't the case. So we got them moving straight away after the first session, getting them doing some weight bearing exercise and activity, as I said.
You're spot on. They sometimes leave the DEXA scans being told, oh God, you've got brittle bones in the bottom of that back or in your hip. And by the time they get to us, they might have normally been a walker. They've stopped walking because they're so scared that they're going to fracture something. Yes, you're at higher risk of fracturing if you have osteoporosis, but you can't stop moving. Movement is key to getting the bone stronger. And something as simple as walking is a great place to start. And little flat surface, start with 5 minutes and build it up as you feel that you can. But if even that's a struggle, even things like stepping at the countertop, lifting one foot up and down, and then even on a step or marching on the spot, 5-10 minutes and build it up. There's loads of different ideas. If you're in any doubt, you can just check in with your healthcare professional and they'll be able to guide you a little bit more on it. But I think, osteoporosis or osteoarthritis, there's stuff that you can do to help.
Good. And do you know what I just noticed?
What?
You're very fetching in your maroon top.
Oh, so are you.
I know, I didn't even realise we were in the same bloody colour. Jeez. Awkward.
Awkward. Well, we're in the same uniform every day.
Yeah, I think we changed.
And I had this on first. You came home and put that on.
I know, yeah, I didn't even
realise. So it's your fault. Can you hear us okay? Can you let us know if you're listening? Just give us a thumbs up if you can hear us okay, because we're a bit away from the camera. Okay, that was our osteoporosis DEXA scan.
So osteoarthritis then. Do you feel you've covered that enough? If it's osteoarthritis, can we do something?
Well, actually, somebody asked us last week, and we didn't get to it, about arthritis, having arthritis in their hip, and they were waiting total hip replacement, and what could they do? So we can probably go back to that again. Well, you tell me, seeing as I talked too much last week, apparently.
So arthritis, again, as Kira said earlier, it is more of your degeneration in the joint, a bit of wear in the joint, basically, but that's expected as we get older. Some people have it more than others, but again, that doesn't mean that you can't limit your activities. It just needs to, you need to maybe adjust or change the activity that you do. So as Kira said, you would, instead of doing pounding the road, maybe running, you would start to do a little bit more cycling or swimming. You can still work pretty hard even though you have your arthritis, to just try and help that joint. Medication then as well, making sure you are using it appropriately, and again, speaking with your GP, And then what we look to do in physiotherapy is to try and build strength around that joint. So often what we find is the muscles around the joint are quite weak, simply because someone has a sore knee or a sore hip, straight away they start to offload it. They don't like putting their weight down through it.
Mm-hmm.
So they're trying to take the weight over onto the other side. And all of an accumulative effect, basically, muscles start to become weak over time on that side. And then when they do try and use it, instead of the muscles absorbing that force, the force is instead starting to go more through the bones and further increasing their pain. So we start strengthening straight away up around that joint,
yeah,
to see if we can help offload that joint simply by building those muscles up. And often we find that that does help alleviate a lot of it, or it can prolong
the time before they need surgery. We've just had clarification there. Thank you. Yeah, it's 68 and osteoarthritis. So, I mean, that mum can definitely do stuff to help reduce her pain. And as Ollie said, it's all about strengthening exercises around that hip. And that will be based on sort of their pain level. So, you know, if somebody's very irritable, we'll do non-weight bearing stuff like side leg lifts or straight leg raises, mm-hmm, if they can tolerate it. Even standing at the countertop, taking the leg out to the side, back in, bringing it out behind you, back in, lifting it up, back down.
Simple range of movement. Even getting in the pool is really, really good for...
I hate that in Donegal we really don't have great access to pools and it can be expensive.
Are they actually closing the
I think so.
The Bayview.
Yeah. We know, like in Donegal Town, our patients
Bayview
do
hotel,
use
Bayview pool.
The pool.
Yeah.
I think they are. If somebody knows for sure, maybe you can let us know. But I know in Donegal Town, our patients do use the Mill Park and the Central, particularly if they've got if their hip arthritis is sore. But when we were in the UK, they used to have hydro pools with, and the physios could go into the hydro pools with them, and it was great. But back to the original question, yes, absolutely. You should not be tolerating osteoarthritis because of age. There's loads they can do. And at 68, like, that's really, really young. And if the arthritis doesn't settle with treatment, then we do talk about to that patient about having a conversation with a surgeon if required. Because a total, like we were talking about last week, a total hip replacement is such a common surgical procedure now with great outcomes, but absolutely physio first and some strengthening exercises around the hip. If you're not sure about the exercises, do get assessed because it differs for everyone, where some people start is different to others depending on your strength. So osteoarthritis, absolutely strengthening exercises around the hip.
Cool, right.
Covered?
Moving on, I think so.
Great,
next one. Hit me.
I keep exiting out of it. It was here. Okay, this one is a bit of an open-ended one, but it'll give us a chance to chat about it. So it says, hi, I would love to know more about plantar fasciitis.
Okay. So plantar fasciitis, so first of all, where is it? It's in the foot. The plantar fascia, so the plantar fasciitis refers to the problem that occurs with plantar fascia. And the plantar fascia runs from the heel, right on the inside of that heel bone, all the way to the web of the foot, to just underneath the pad, the fat pad underneath your toes, basically, or the ball of the foot, that's the word I was looking for. And that actually supports the foot. So if you can imagine that, so if that's your foot, so we've got a slight curve in the foot, and then all it is the plantar fascia comes underneath it, and it keeps it nice and tight to support that arch. Now, often what we find is the plantar fascia, it goes wrong more commonly in, again, middle-aged women. What do you think that is?
Well, it's middle-aged women who are slightly overweight. So
again,
something going on there with pressure.
Pressure, and also, again,
potentially, Ollie loves blaming hormones.
But it is like you can literally list all the conditions.
Who else is common in?
It's common in young athletic males.
Yeah.
Again, I would say probably hormones as well, with the increase in load as well.
Yeah.
So two similar population groups that occurs in. Can you tell me a little bit more about
symptoms?
Mm-hmm.
These patients come in with a gradual onset of heel pain. It is the most common reason for heel pain in adults, and we would see that in clinic as well. So they'll come in and they won't have remembered a particular incident. It's gradually got worse over time. Most of the pain is on the inside, right at the back towards the heel. they'll often say that if they're sitting, it's fine, but it's worse after they stand from a period of rest. So those initial steps of weight bearing.
First thing in the morning.
Yeah, when they get out of bed.
Getting up out of bed. Yeah.
Or if you've been sitting for a while and then you go to stand, then you'll feel the pain as well. And then as you get moving, the pain can improve slightly, but if you are weight bearing for a prolonged time, so if you have to stand or you're caught walking for quite a while, the pain will get worse.
It can often feel like there's a small little stone or a pebble right under your heel. It can be really, really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So what can you do for it?
What can they do for it? Well, I guess the key thing is that we know a few things from the studies on plantar fasciitis, that 80% of people with plantar fasciitis have tightness in their calf. So if there's tightness on the Achilles tendon, it increases the stretch on the plantar fascia. And we think that that increased stretch and then load is what irritates it. So first and foremost, we have to try and decrease the load, whatever form that takes.
Okay, so what does that mean?
It means if you are somebody who the pain gets worse if you're standing for prolonged periods or when you're walking, then initially in clinic we would say try to reduce that. So try not to find yourself getting caught standing for too long. If you're working at a checkout, is there an option to have a perching stool so you can take the pressure off if you need to? Try to avoid, like we'll often say, avoid those long walks in the initial period to try and settle it down. Oh, the other thing is that again, just going back to the symptoms, when we look at people with plantar fasciitis, 80% of symptomatic people with plantar fasciitis have an overpronation of their arch.
What's that mean?
It means that they look like they've got flat feet.
Or duck feet, sometimes people
have. Not even duck feet, but the arch comes down. Pronation is. So that then brings us back to possible treatment options. Now, people go straight for orthotics. That's not what we do. Like, that is the last step.
Well, you mentioned already the calf is tight and we can adjust the load. So,
so
we would start with calf stretches.
Yeah,
even if you Google
stretches.
Calf stretches or YouTube calf stretches, it's really simple. You can do it either against the wall or against hanging off the edge of a step. And there's two types. So there's two muscles mainly in the calf. And we've got our gastroc and our soleus. So there's two different stretches that we want to really try and do to try and isolate those muscles, to really stretch them. And loosen that off, to try and take as much pressure off that plantar fascia as we can. And then the other one, as you said, moderate your load appropriately. What else can they do?
So then we would look at footwear. So where we come in, we try these basics first. Footwear is a massive one with us. So people will come in with their heel pain and the first thing I'll look at is what's on their feet, what shoes are on their feet. We think with plantar fasciitis, you want a cushion support under the arch. So you don't want anything too hard up against it, but you need a cushion support under the arch, a good, nice sole of the foot, and a laced up shoe. So a good supportive shoe will take pressure off the fascia. So that's another thing we can change straight away if we need to. Now, what is a good shoe, Ollie? This drives me mad.
What is a good shoe? That's a good question. A good shoe is a supportive, comfortable shoe, as Kira said, it has laces. There's certainly a few brands
careful
out there, maybe. It rhymes with stretchers, but I won't say what brand it is. And basically what happens is, I'll just show you, and then, like, if you can grab a shoe, and I should really block out that logo, shouldn't I?
If you can grab a shoe
and you can literally crunch that shoe and squash it right up, I mean, that's not giving you a whole lot of support. Now, if you have those shoes that rhyme with stretchers, there's nothing wrong with them.
Absolutely.
If you don't
not.
Have foot pain.
The problem
if you
with
have
them
foot
is,
pain,
yeah, people
I would
think
not be wearing them.
They're really comfortable and they're good for your feet. If you have no foot problems, it's completely fine. But if you have foot pain, you need something a bit more supportive. So we would definitely have a good discussion on footwear with our plantar fasciitis patients. If symptoms are not settling, then we would start to think about what more we could help in their footwear. So we would, first of all, usually try a bit of taping to tape the plantar fascia and arch. Now, that's a very short-term measure, obviously, but if that helps, that gives us an indicator about what else we could do with their footwear to help their plantar fascia long-term. And things like a deep heel cup, which again, these are things that your physio, your healthcare professional, or your podiatrist can help with. A deep heel cup will help the plantar fascia as well. And we will try all those things before we go to the invasive option of orthotics. Because often patients come into us saying, oh, I've heel pain, do I need orthotics? And actually that's our last step, because you don't want to be putting in interventions that people don't need. But if pain doesn't settle, orthotics are an option. And we will look at off-the-shelf options depending on the foot. If they have quite an overpronation and their foot really isn't going to be an off-the-shelf option, then we would consider custom orthotics. And if it's really complicated, we will cross over with our other healthcare professionals, so podiatrists can help us out with this as well if we're really struggling to get these symptoms settled down. So let's quickly recap there, make sure we didn't miss anything. We'd offload, first of all.
Sorry, I was just reading some of the comments. Someone just said they took their stretchers off. Brilliant.
Sketchers? Oh, sugar! I said it. No, but if you don't have foot pain, they're fine.
If you don't have foot pain, they're absolutely fine. But when it starts to go wrong, take them off, because they're not giving you a whole lot of support. So,
okay, recap. We offload. Stop irritating it.
Offload. Moderate your load, all right, to really try and ease the pain.
Where possible.
Stretch. All right. Google calf stretches, either on against the wall or hanging over the edge of a step. Next is?
We would consider adjuncts, and so good supportive footwear, using a good cushioning underneath the arch, heel cup taping, short-term measures to see if it helps.
Right, and heel cup, I mean, you could probably get a heel cup if you Google it, or Amazon. Or
the pharmacist sometimes have simple heel cups that you can try. If you're in any doubt though, do check in with your healthcare professional. The other thing, and we nearly forgot it, the thing that we most push is strengthening.
Yeah. So again, the Achilles, the plantar fascia, again, it's all about load. So often it's a sudden change in load which causes this condition. So again, it goes from a period of maybe where someone is inactive for a little while, and all of a sudden they have a sudden increase in activity. That tendon or that plantar fascia isn't used to that load. So what happens is it starts to become really, really irritated at where it attaches, right on that heel bone. And it's that sudden increase in activity that really sets it all off. So what we want to try and do is we want to deload it first of all by reducing your activities, and then we want to start to reload it so it's getting it stronger and getting it used to absorbing those load again. Frustrating condition, because it can go on for quite a while. It can take a good while for that to settle down and to actually get it used to taking that load again.
So we would start
once the pain starts to settle down a little bit, we would start throwing some heel raises at people. So we double heel raises, stand up on your tiptoes, hold for 2 or 3 seconds, lower back down nice and gentle. Obviously,
ankle inversion, eversion, toe flexor strength, we can help you with all of that. We have to do a shout out to the podiatrists here who are commenting. Yes, absolutely, there's a whole
profession
that just deals with feet, and they are the podiatrists, and they are absolutely specialists in feet. Patients do come into us with heel pain, and when we're struggling or we think it's beyond our profession, we will absolutely refer to the podiatrist. So, you know, if you're having problems with your plantar fasciitis and your podiatrists are close by, they will be able to help as well. So a shout out to all the podiatrists out there. We definitely work with them where we can, and you know, if we're struggling, we will definitely pick up the phone and call them to see if they have any ideas on how we can help.
Do you reckon they've got like a foot fetish to just work solely with feet? I don't know if I could do just solely feet.
I
don't mind them, but I just like a mix of everything.
I like a good foot every now and again.
It's like a good mix.
Always 9 o'clock. We haven't got through half these questions again.
One more. Okay. Coffee's almost gone.
Hold on. Where did that one go? There was one there about somebody.
Yes, another thing that you can do. Yeah, a cold floor helps the plantar fasciitis. Another really great tip is getting a cold can out of the fridge or out of the freezer, and it's even just putting it down, putting the arch of your foot down on it, and just rolling your foot over and back nice and gentle in against that cold can, and that can be quite soothing for someone that is quite sore and quite irritable. So definitely nice cold therapy helps ease that discomfort.
Okay, there's one here about total hip replacement. What were you going to say? Someone has just asked, is there any point in attending physiotherapy if they're due to have a total hip replacement?
Yes, is the short answer. The long answer is, so when you have total hip replacement, again, the condition of the muscles around that hip tend to be quite weakened before you go in for that operation. And it's simply weakened because, again, as we mentioned earlier, you want to offload it, it's sore, you don't like taking your weight through it, so you tend to lean over to the other side when you're walking, and all those muscles then start to become really, really weak. But you can strengthen those muscles without having to take all that force and all that weight through them. So by doing sideline exercises, you can start to really build that strength back up in around that hip. And what that means is then once you have the surgery, you're already starting from a better position because the muscles are already strong, because after surgery, what the focus is to really try and build those muscles back up to really support it and get you a nice even gait or a nice even walking pattern. Because the surgery itself goes through, I don't want to put anyone off going for a total hip replacement, but it goes through one of the important muscles on the outside of the hip, and that muscle then becomes quite weak after surgery. So a lot of what physios do is to spend time just slowly building up the muscles around
and
the hip.
Just to be clear here, if patients come into us and they're due their surgery, there's not like 10 physio appointments before their surgery. We set them up on a strengthening program. We might only see them once or maybe twice, to just do as much work as they can pre-op so that they're as strong as possible, which helps post-op. That's the goal. Keep it as strong as possible when you're going in. So your physio should not be seeing you week on, week on, week on. It's literally...
There's no need. As long as you're happy.
Happy doing the exercises.
Doing your exercises and you're...
So like a one-off appointment will get you set up. And then, however, once you've had your hip, you know, checking back in with them afterwards as soon as possible to check everything's going okay.
But generally they'll refer you anyway for physio.
Well,
after.
Not routinely. Yeah. But some people are fine. It's if you're having trouble, then see your physio.
I would always build strength after surgery.
I know, but...
Anyway, my coffee is gone, so I think that's all we've got time for. We'll come back next week, but anyone that we haven't got to, just keep sending us your questions, and what we can do then is have them all ready to go, and we'll do quick fire questions next week. I'll try and stop Kira from rambling on too much next week. All right.
Thanks, guys.
Cheers, guys.
Thanks for watching.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Have a good weekend.